you know, sections and things like that in college that you're going to have to go to. It's really how you mature, you know. I think college matures a lot of people, and I was one of those people. Try not to get a credit card. I'm not going to talk to you today unless you're able to pay it. I thought a credit card, they'd be like, oh, you get free money, and then you can pay it back later. It's like, yeah. Wait. I don't have any money, though. So no payments back. So can I take a loan to pay back a credit card? Yeah, I was SOL after a while. But it's a lot. It's great. Don't be too nervous about it. It'll be a fun experience. Right? That's great. That's great.
Nice. Well,
they're
all
Western.
Okay. What are they called?
Cedar Max. So Cedar Waterfall.
Okay.
They got Cedar.
That's sweet. Just had a goal. Graduating from college has been a goal since I was a kid. You know, I mean, nobody in my family had done it. I always felt like I'd be the one to do it. You know, I always felt driven. And just felt like my college education was really important. I felt like it allowed me to be successful regardless of if I got through football and got to NFL and all that. If I graduated from Stanford, got my degree, you know, a lot of doors opened up, and that's how I felt. So that was a great motivation, a great drive, you know, to provide biochemistry. And, you know, it's going to be a couple classes in there, and you're going to be like, wow. You speak a different language than I'm speaking, but you still find a way. You know, that's when you really find out who you are. How much are you willing to study? How much are you willing to sit in office hours with your professor? How much are you willing to? It's humbling. It's humbling because you're not. You may have been the smartest in your high school, and I was second. I was second in my class. And then you get to college, and some subjects I'm smartest with, and then others, I mean, in Chinese. Any other questions?
What was your favorite subject in college?
There was something in college. Sociology. Because sociology was studying society, the study of how people interact with one another, study of social media. And I just felt it was intriguing. Everything else was pretty standard, math, economics, English, literature, the humanities. I also like Greek mythology, learning about, you know, the way they looked at the world back then. You know, they thought there was a god for the sun, a god for the earth, a god for it. It was pretty interesting. You know, all the stories like Troy and Hercules, and, you know, learning about all those stories. It was pretty cool culture. Not sure I believe all of it, but, you know, cool stories to hear about. I mean, I don't believe the Disney Channel movies, but they're good to see.
What was it like growing up?
It was tough. We didn't have a lot of money, didn't have a lot of resources, obviously. A lot of people, obviously there was a lot of gangs and violence everywhere, every poverty-stricken area of America, of any city, any country. But it also had to, I felt like our city felt bad at that, because of all the violence. And nonsense, but there were a lot of great people. You know, I think some of the brightest lights shine in the darkest places because you have to. You know, you got teachers there who make nothing, who have to deal with, I mean, terrible kids on a day in, day out basis. And not to say they're all terrible kids, but, you know, I mean, you got kids cursing teachers out, threatening to fight, and stuff like that. And then these teachers are putting their school, everything into making sure kids that care about school will make it. So I enjoyed my experience growing up because I feel like it molded me into who I am today, and I don't think I would be who I am without the circumstances I had, adversity I went through, things I saw as a kid. Some of them were unfortunate, but, you know, that's what it is.
What was your biggest challenge in life?
Biggest challenge in life? Overcoming your own self-doubt. Because that's the biggest step for anybody out there is believing that you can do it. Because it doesn't matter if everybody in the world says you can do it. If you don't believe you can do it, you're not going to do it. you're not getting done. I don't care what happens. I don't care what potential you have, what skill you have. If you don't ever believe, you're never going to get it done. And if you believe and nobody else believes, you're going to surprise the world. You know, that's what I had to, that's what I had to believe. Because coming from Compton, you know, they just tell you, you're going to be a drug dealer, you're going to jail, you're going to work minimum wage job, or you're going to steal. That's it. You know, there's no, still going up, you're not going to be any superstar, you're not going to be any anything. You know, you're not going to be a doctor or lawyer. You know, those are your options. And I kind of wanted to kick that stereotype. I wanted to, you know, you're not going to tell me what I'm going to do and what I'm not going to do. So I believe in, with every bit of my heart that I can make it out, that I can make it be successful. And not just in football, you know, I wasn't going to limit myself there. I really wanted to be like sports commentator. I thought I would be a talking head, you know, in there. Yeah, I would have really been killing Skip Davis if they would let me do what I was going to do. But that's what I was really, what I was really going into. And then thankfully I was blessed and got the opportunity to play for the Seahawks and was successful in what I did, played great, and the rest is history. But I think it was the belief that I found in myself, and it was in high school my sophomore year, where I started to believe that anything was possible. Like I could do it, I could win races, I could get straight A's, the sky's the limit. And I think once that kind of took a lot of shackles off of me. I started playing free, I started being free, I started believing in myself and other people started believing me. You know, because in high school Compton, who's gonna believe in you? Ain't nobody gonna believe in you, you know, or you. You're just a snotty-nosed kid in Compton. That's not gonna be anything. I mean, that's really all they look at. And then when the light starts to shine in you because you believe in yourself, it becomes contagious. Yes. So down, overcome that. What you got? You look like you got something. What's my backup plan? In terms of what? I just told you I was going to be a sports commentator. I mean, I still got job offers for a couple tech companies, small startups. I got friends in high places now. You know, I mean, that's one of the cool things about going to Stanford. You go to Stanford and you meet the guy who made Instagram, you meet the guy who made Snapchat, you know, you meet the, you know, a lot of the CEOs from Yahoo and Google and Amazon and things like that. So they're, you know, I got a lot of friends in those places, and that's what I was gonna be. If sports commentating didn't work out, then I was gonna be an executive at one of those companies. They're probably gonna try to make me cut my hair, but that's the story. We didn't have to do it. It's pretty good, man. My parents work hard. My mom works mentally, physically disabled kids. My dad drives trash trucks, picks up trash every day. And they both got home probably 3 or 4 o'clock. You know, after they left at 8 o'clock in the morning. My dad left at 4, so long days for him. But it was great, man. If you went to our house, you'd never think of it before. You never think before, I mean, other than the things that you obviously see, a bunch of roaches and rats and stuff. But otherwise, it was a happy household. You know, my parents did as good of a job as you could do within the circumstances that we had. And I think that helped. You know, having a strong household obviously helped. You know, my parents.
They got a lot of support on.
Yes, a ton of support. That helped. I thank them back. You know, every day, I thank them. You know, I just bought, like I said, I bought a house. And they're pretty happy with it, but you know, it's one of those things where you appreciate your parents, you appreciate the sacrifice they make day in, day out, you know, going to work, even putting us in sports. You know, we don't have the money to freaking buy a bunch of meals, so you putting this extra money in buying cleats and stuff, you know, you appreciate those sacrifices. These are the only people asking questions. Y'all don't got no questions.
What was like a transition from college football
to that? It's sad. Well, I think the hard transition was high school to college. Because in high school, you play some teams where it's like, oh, these guys are pretty good. And then you play some teams, it's like, y'all just go get everybody out of class and bring them out here. You know what I mean? Not everybody's got some. There's a big difference. know, in college, everybody's on scholarship, and they're fast, and you've got the fast. In high school, it's like, oh, we're playing these guys? All right, so let me go get, eat this Jack in the Box at McDonald's, because it's going to be expected. And it was just, when you get from college to NFL, you're playing against the best of the best. But when you get to the NFL from college, you're playing against grown men. You know, I mean, these 35-year-old men with five kids and family, you know, it's a different kind of strength. It's a different kind of drive, a different kind of motivation. It's a different game than that's a grown man. And in college, you didn't really have guilt. I mean, other, say it's a BYU, has probably 30-year-old men, but I've been, unfortunately. But yeah, it's fast. I'm still catching up to these technologies.
Who was your hero growing up?
Muhammad Ali. Outside of my dad and my brother and my parents, obviously. But yeah, Muhammad Ali was a great influence. I'm going to turn my back. I appreciate all y'all good questions. You got my jersey sitting right there. I got a couple questions. Because I was only 20 number 11. If I put me in 30, I said, come on now, y'all know. Name somebody who was exceeding 30 that plays me. Put on 30 and get cut the next day. I guess it's the same as it's always been, you know. I mean, nobody ever believed in the beginning. So now, because a few more people believe, it doesn't change anything. A few more people don't believe, it doesn't change anything. Just go out there and do my job day in, day out. It really doesn't matter, you know. You got to make it so obvious that you're good that it sounds stupid to say anything else, and that's what I try to make it.
What do you like to do on your
downtime? My downtime? Well, I just got a boat, so I try to go fishing, travel a little bit.
Want some nuts?
You want some nuts? I didn't catch a nut. I caught a shooter the other day. Yeah. What you be catching, though?
What do you catch?
What do you catch? Got a question for you now. I'm always decided to speak to speak to you guys. Are, don't consider yourself kids. You guys are young adults, because I feel like that's the, you guys are the future. You know, that's, everybody says it, but you realize that once you get older, you know, like, they say we're kind of ruining everything for you guys with these cell phones and stuff. I got to see what you're saying. But it's cool to see people when I sat in your shoes, you know, I understand what you guys are going through and to try to give you guys a message that I wish somebody would gave me when I was in your shoes, you know, the information I wish I would got going into college, because it's a life-changing experience. It's hard to prepare yourself for that kind of change, that kind of drastic change, not living at home anymore, not living under your parents, just being so dependent on yourself day in and day out. Sometimes some people get homesick. Some people love college. Some people hate it because, you know, they're not good at making friends. They're not understanding the world. They feel isolated. And I just want to help you guys make that transition. You know, when you were acting, like, answer your question and give you my support.
What is your acting going to get?
I mean, it's kind of one of those things where it's like, I mean, you'll see it when you play on Sunday. You know, I mean, we don't. It's more exciting, I guess, for the fans. When all that stuff happens for us, it's like, I mean, we'll see how he plays. And if he plays well, then we'll be happy. And if he doesn't, then we'll keep playing how we always play. But if he plays well, then we'll be happy to have him. You know, he's a great player. He's done a lot of great things in this league. He's looking like he's about to give a question.
What is the Green Bay game?
The Green Bay game, that was a tough game, bro. We won. it went over battle, man. It was a great day. I think it'll go down to one of the best games in the franchise. Yeah, but I think we always end up in battle in the NFC Championship. I mean, Frisco was a freaking, that was a headache game, too, until the end. Tip and slap and then.
What about your friend Maxwell?
See, that's an interesting question. You think, at this point, you think your friends in high school are your friends for life?
You have a lot of peer pressure?
Yeah, I probably don't. But I'm a weirdo. You know, I'm kind of square. I'm kind of off the beaten track kind of person. So, you know, peer pressure didn't really do anything for me. I was more the guy, you want to go do that? Go do it. I'm going to go right over here and go to this class real quick because I got some money to make later on. So, you know, because it depends on what you look at as your ego. You know what I mean? Peer pressure can be a good thing, it can be a bad thing. It's always looked at negatively. But you can also influence your peers to do positive things. I think peer pressure is an issue for everyone, you know, every level. They'd be lying if they said it wasn't. But I felt so confident in what I was doing. Like I said, I felt like shackles were released. That I felt so confident in understanding that if I just did my work in school, played hard, that I would have a chance to go to college. And that was my tunnel vision goal. So if you want to stand out here and stand outside of class just to walk around at a school, why would you even come to school to walk around for nothing? That's the stupidest thing I've heard of. And it's like you're not even doing anything. You already came to school. And you're not going to go to class. So you're going to walk around for the hour that you couldn't just be sitting in class. No. You know, I just don't understand. So eventually people start to catch on, though. They start to catch on. It's like, oh, why don't we just go to class for a few minutes? Then we don't. Why don't we just go to class for a few days? Then it's like, why don't we just do our work? You know, and then peer pressure ends up being a positive thing. People start doing their work, and a lot of those kids actually start to graduate that wouldn't have graduated otherwise. So I dealt with both ways.
What is the... What's the number one thing you learned during the third game? Go against
family. Yeah. Family. That's like the one stabilizing force that I have in my life. And then you turn to yourself. You've got to look yourself in the mirror sometimes. You know, it's not, you don't every day wake up. At least I don't wake up every day and have a great day. You know, sometimes you have a bad day and you're like, man, who you think you are, you know? Are you going to play well today? You know what I mean? I have off days just like everybody else. I'm human. But you have to have that belief in yourself. You have to have something that stabilizes yourself every day. As you look for, whether that's your family members, whether that's, I don't know, whether you have a dog, you know, I don't know if you have a brother, a friend, somebody that you can come to that gives you that reassurance. And even it's yourself. Sometimes it's self-reassurance. Sometimes you just got to look at yourself and say, yeah, you that man. Awesome. Cool. You know what I mean? Sometimes you got to look at yourself and say, yeah, you the man. You the man. You forgot me for a day, but you the man. You know, I mean, I've played football. I've had bad games. And you walk away like, man, do I even know how to play? Do I even know how to play again? And then the next game, you have a great game. And it's like, yeah, what was that last week? You know what I mean? But that's just how it goes. It's how the cycle goes. Nobody's perfect. And you have to realize that.
Thank you.
I
You guys are about 100% actually. All things. That's starting to happen. I just love you guys. Hey, Sam. Happy to see you. Have you?
I see that on Snapchat.
Justin, have your voice going.
Yeah, we're just waiting. Thank you, Bernie.
Just wait for the last one.
I'm with you guys. I'm with you guys.
How are you, Johnny?
Hey, how you doing?
Good to see you. Right.